I like to talk about practical successes because that's what it's all about, right? We can theorize till the cows come home, and then even after that, and that works to some extent, but we have to see how it works in practice. Now here we see on these leaves, we see all these little mealy bugs, yeah? And there are some more, and there are some more, and so forth. Now these mealy bugs, normally we treat them with coccinella. Coccinella is a remedy. It's made from the ladybug, and the ladybug is the natural predator of practically all soft-bodied insects except caterpillars, because caterpillars are a little bit too big for them. Yeah, but for the rest, any soft-bodied insect, the coccinella will take care of. Yeah, so you can use it against mealybugs, against aphids, against some species of whitefly, and then usually only the larvae of the whitefly. You can use it against some species of scale. If the scale is soft-bodied, then it's okay. If it's hard-bodied, the coccinella can do nothing with it. It's simply too hard for him to deal with. Yeah. Now, here are some more, as you can see, on the stems. Yeah. And so these things were, at some point, we gave it coccinella. Here is more of the same thing. Yeah, this is all these white mealybugs, and we gave it coccinella, and then afterwards, all these little things were gone. Now they didn't send me any picture of that. Then here we have. This was before treatment. Now you can see here on the stem, there all, you see all these aphids, yeah. And the aphids, as the other lady was explaining this morning, they always go for the young leaf because they go for the soft stuff. Yeah, just like little children, they like the soft stuff. And here we have some more of the same. And here we have some more of the same. And now we show you what happens after treatment. You see that here there is nothing left, and this is the same branch as you saw before with all these aphids on it, and that's 24 hours later. Wow. Yeah, so coccinella, 24 hours, aphids gone, and they will not come back for at least 3 months. Yeah, so one application is sufficient. Instead of going after the bug, we actually need to treat the plant, because the bug is only a symptom. Yeah, and if we are chasing the bug, then we are just like the silly allopaths, and we will always lose the battle, because at some point or other, yeah, they will come back. So chasing the bug is not a good idea. You have to treat the plant, and the plant has symptoms, and why does it have those symptoms? We have to find out what are the conditions that cause these things to appear. Now usually that is because the plant is in a weak position. Yeah, either under the soil or in the soil, so something is out of balance, yeah? Not enough nutrients, or an imbalance in the bacterial or fungal entities that live there. Yeah, because it is one whole. And by giving the remedy to the plant, to the roots of the plant, the things that are under the soil will also change. Yeah, because the remedy is like in the human being. If somebody has a rash, we give him sulfur, and then everything inside his body is also changing. It is not just that the sulfur works only on the rash, because his mind changes, and his whole demeanor changes. And we know that sulfur is the great unwashed. Well, suddenly he will go wash himself. Yeah. So there is a complete systemic change. And so the same with the remedy. If you give it to the roots, then you have a systemic change, which is also pertaining to the soil. Yeah. And the soil is the regular chemical agriculturists. They say, well, it is. It is only a medium to suspend the plant and to suspend nutrients, and that's all they think about. Now, before somebody was talking about compacted soil. Compacted soil is mainly because there is no organic matter in the soil. Organic matter is very important. We have climate change everywhere, and we have all this so-called global warming. Well, that is half of it is caused by wrong agricultural practices, because the sun rays that come on the soil are immediately reflected back up. Nothing is retained. Yeah, and that is because the soil has no organic content. If the soil has organic content, the soil is 10 degrees cooler than the air above it at least. And so because it is cooler, it will absorb the warmth and it will release its coolness. And in this way, the temperature will go down. Yeah, just like everywhere we cut down the forest. If you cut down the forest, what do you get? You get a hotter planet. Everybody who goes in the summer into the forest, he notices that in the forest it's nice and cool. And where it is nice and cool, you have a low pressure. And where there is low pressure, it attracts rain. So if you cut down all the forest, you stop having rain. In Australia, they have big problems, 13 years drought. Why? Because all the trees are gone. Australia used to be covered in trees. There is 15% left. And there is still forest as big as Germany. Yeah. So we can see that by removing the forest, we produce climate change. And then everybody says this is because of CO2, but CO2 is less than 1% actually of the content of the atmosphere. So CO2 is a hoax, in my not so humble opinion. Yeah. So here we have the coccinella. Now this was in New Zealand. This is an apple orchard, and as you can see, there is hardly any leaves on the trees. And that was because of a wasp, yeah, a gall wasp. And the gall wasp was destroying all his trees. And the only ones alive are the chickens, yeah, properly alive, that is. And so he asked me what to give, and I said, well, treat it with coccinella. And this is like 10 days later after the treatment. And you see how all the leaves are beginning to grow. And things are coming into much better order.
I think the chickens are dead.
Pardon?
Pardon? The chickens are dead.
Yeah, the chickens are dead now.
The wasps are alive.
Yeah, but the trees are alive. And you know, the chickens he keeps for fun, but the trees he keeps for business. He may have also eaten all those chickens, who knows?
Why did you pick coccinella for the wasp?
Pardon?
Why did you pick coccinella for the wasp?
Because it is the larvae of the wasp that caused the problem.
Oh, the larvae. Okay.
And the larvae are soft-bodied, and the coccinella can deal with that. Yeah. And here we have cucumber. Now, here you see those veins, yeah? How they are pale, and actually this is the beginning of a fungal disease. This is like powdery mildew. Now what can you do about that? You see how the leaves are hanging down. They don't have too much energy. Yeah, and that's because they are inhibited in passing on the and this is after treatment. Now fungal diseases, Rudolf Steiner already says this, silica is the greatest antifungal. Silica is the main remedy that I use for fungal diseases, and I use everything in the 6X because my experience has taught me that works the best. Yeah. Also, when you use a homeopathic remedy, if you use it the way that humans are using it, we get remedies that have had 10 succussions. I give 50 succussions because you have to cover a larger area, and so you need more energy. Yeah, so 50 succussions is sufficient for the remedy to have a very good positive effect. Sometimes I think you can even give more. Yeah, but I think that it also depends on the problem. If the problem is very severe and the plant is having a good vitality, then you give more succussions. But if the plant doesn't have such good vitality and you give more succussions, then it's too energetic and you may kill the plant.
Do you have to be careful? careful what time of day you do that?
Not really. Of course, the best thing is to do things like this when it is overcast, because UV light destroys the remedy. Yeah, but because you give it to the roots and it penetrates, it takes a while before the remedy is has been destroyed that way. Then,
sorry, root fungus.
Pardon?
Is good too for the root fungus?
Yeah, for the root fungus, the same thing. Silica. Same thing, silica. Silica, I have not seen any fungal disease that will not react to silica. Yeah, but then I have not seen everything yet. And I did most of my experiments in Australia before the lady was saying she has potentized the aphids. Well, I can tell you, I tried that in Australia and it never worked. Yeah, so that may be because of different circumstances. Yeah. UV.
Yeah. UV.
Yeah, that's ultraviolet, not infrared.
Sorry.
Yeah.
What evidence?
we keep all the remedies in brown bottles to stop the UV from destroying the remedies, because if we keep them in clear bottles and we sit them on the shelf, after some time, it will be gone. Yeah. So then it simply no longer works. Yeah. So. That is why the remedies have been put in brown bottles to stop the UV from entering.
Sir, may I ask you to put some light on sickle core in fungal?
I have no experience with that, so I cannot put any light on there.
Right. You have no light?
No, not on that. let me see. No, this one first. Here we have the gall wasp. Now you see how there are these big bubbles come on the leaves, yeah? And the gall wasp. Now how do you get at that? Because the thing is inside the leaf.
It's peach tree? What is it?
This is actually a mango.
A mango.
Yeah, and this was in India in the ashram where I'm a member. And they sent me these photographs and asked me what to do. So I said, well, my experience says that you give this tuya. And why tuya? Because tuya is for animal poisoning in people. So then it's also for animal poisoning in plants. And what is happening there with the gall wasp is animal poisoning. It's very simple. Yeah. So they gave it a dose of tuya. And I shall show you what happens after the dose of tuya was given. This is 48 hours later. Yeah. So all these bubbles are gone, and so is the gall wasp. Yeah? And the whole season, we have not seen any gall wasp back. And that is from a single dose. Everything is always single dose. I'm a classical man. I say single dose, bust, and then see what happens. Yeah? Wait and see. So gall wasp, you can, and anything that penetrates the leaves, like you have these leaf miners, yeah, and leaf borers and beetles that penetrate the bark of the tree and that go under the bark, well, you cannot reach it with the remedy. Yeah, but you can give tuya and they will disappear. In Canada, they have, at the moment, they have this emerald ash borer, which was imported from China, and all the ash trees are dying very rapidly. Well, we have given tuya to some of those trees and they survive. And the ones that you don't treat, they simply die. It's because the ash borer goes under the bark and ring barks it on the inside. And as soon as the tree is ring barked, you can say goodbye. Yeah, and that's the same with they have also a pine borer, which is also imported. I tried to get an appointment with the forestry department there, and in the beginning they showed some interest. But then, of course, these guys are all thinking about their position. And if somebody comes with something that works, and they have never come with something that works, they are afraid to lose their jobs. Mm-hmm. And so they decline to talk to me. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Can I be sorry, going on the symptoms of the plants themselves, was the deformation that made you come up with tuya, or
No, the fact that it's inside the leaf, and right. So that it is an animal poison inside the leaf, and you can't reach it anyway, okay. Anyway else, because it's all enclosed.
Yeah, well, what yeah. Was like the warting, you know, the way that you get warting yeah. And stuff with
yeah.
Would
it looks like warty, and
yeah.
Yeah, and it's animal poisoning, so go for tuya, and that works. Yeah.
Caffeine is a fungus, it's not an animal.
What?
Caffeine is a feature.
Well, the gall wasp is an animal, it's a wasp.
Ah, in Bangor was not caffeine deformans, it was a wasp.
The one with the bubbles here that I just showed you here, this is a wasp and it goes inside the leaves. Yeah, and that creates these bubbles.
Huh?
Yeah.
That is a fungus.
Ah. Yeah, the fungus is carried by the gall wasp. The gall wasp is the cause. And the fungus is the result because it carries it along with it. And it infects the trees. The wasp is the vector for the fungus. Yeah?
But I see trees with a total infestation yeah. By humidity conditions. By
yeah.
Ah? Not by wasp flying glass.
It's another pathogen.
Yeah, it is another pathogen.
For the peach tree especially.
Yes.
Yeah.
And in the case of your fungus there, you give silica and you will see that it works.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Is this 2-year 6X you're talking about?
Yes, this is 2-year 6X. It's always 6X what I use. Yeah? Because I have done experiments with the different ones. In Brazil they have done experiments. They use the 200 and they get the opposite effect, yeah, in the CH, yeah. So they use the 200 CH and they get completely the opposite effect of what they wanted to achieve. And so I can show you that in a little while also, because I have some reports from them, yeah. Here, the grapevines. This is before, yes. You see how all these leaves are curled up?
Yeah.
This is from some fungal disease. They never told me what kind of fungus it was, but they said it is fungal. Yeah. So these grapevines, all the leaves are curled up. There were no berries growing. Yeah. And so they asked me what to do. And they said, well, okay, then use silica. And this is afterwards. You see on the left, you see the new growth. Yeah. On the right is still the old leaves. The old leaves, they do improve a little bit. The curling goes away a bit, but not completely. But all the new growth, as you can see, is completely healthy. Yeah. And never a problem again. And they had very, very nice grapes with it. Now, grapes sometimes get a fungus. I think it is a Phytophthora fungus. And the vintners in Germany and in France, they actually like it, because then the berries, they become shriveled and they produce much more sugar. And the wine that is coming from that is having a better taste. Yeah. So sometimes in grapevines, yeah, you have a fungus that is actually beneficial rather than detrimental. Yeah. Because they get better wines from that and that it gets higher prices. So if you have vineyards in Spain, yeah, have a good look at what is the fungus. And if the fungus is that specific fungus, don't do anything, because the wine will be better. Yeah?
But if we don't do anything, we lose many of the crop, many of the harvest.
No, you don't. All they do is shrink it.
Yeah?
Yeah?
What kind of fungus is
this? I have that.
It's called noble rot.
Yes, noble rot. Yeah, that's
so
the common name.
A rotting which is desired.
Yeah.
It comes at the end of the season anyway.
Yes, it comes at the end of the season. Here.
Potrytis,
huh? Yeah.
Edelfoile. Yeah, edelfoile, yeah.
It's not potrytis. No, it's not.
Yes. Oh. So, here we have some kiwis. Yeah, this is a bit of a small picture. I shall see if I can enlarge it a bit. Yeah, and the kiwi didn't want to grow at all. And the kiwi was actually the year before had suffered from some disease and it didn't want to grow. And so this looks to me like carbo vegetabilis, loss of vital fluids. Yeah, you have that also in plants. And so I told him, okay, you give this carbo veg, and this is like from the exact same point taken, because you can see the bend in the branch is exactly the same, and look how green it is. This is 2 weeks later. Yeah. So one dose of carbo veg, and woof, everything went green. Yeah, it's very very beautiful. And sometimes there is a companion plant to all the vines, and it doesn't make a difference whether this is a grapevine, the kiwi vine, or the cucurbita. Yeah, because the cucurbita are also vines, and that companion plant is called the Ricinus communis, or castor oil. Castor oil is a remedy. If you give this in the beginning of the season to any vine, yeah, the whole growing season, it will remain free of pests and diseases. So you do it as a preventative.
Castor oil is the Ricinus communis.
Yes. And so you use that as a remedy at the beginning of the season, before anything starts growing, you give that to the vines. And when the vines then start really growing up, you will have no pests and no diseases for the whole season.
Prophylactics.
No, yes.
No pests,
no disease.
No fungus, nothing.
Nothing.
Okay.
Yeah, Ricinus communis is most important. It is the most important companion plant for all vines.
Castor oil.
Yeah, I did a lot of stuff in. Oh, let me see. That was a lot of tests with companion plants, and companion plants are actually quite fantastic. You can plant the companion plants, but you know, most harvesters are not equipped for two different plants, and it will clog it up. So instead of using the companion plant, you use the companion plant as a remedy, and then you fool nature into believing that the companion plant is there. Yeah, and in the 6X you still have pheromones, and all companion planting works with pheromones. Yeah, so because the pheromone is there, yeah, and because the plant takes it up, it is like as if he had taken that from the companion plant itself, and therefore expresses these qualities, and that is how you can keep your plants free of pests and diseases. So it's actually quite simple. To avoid all the problems, yeah. Prevention is better than cure, yeah. So I am focusing more and more on prevention. Here we have a microwave test. Yeah, we water was boiled in a microwave oven and then let cool down, and other water was boiled in a normal kettle and let cool down, and then we said, okay, let's see what happens if we feed this to plants.
No, so here.
Huh?
This goes on around in the internet.
Yeah.
You did that?
Yes, I did it also. Because, you know, there is also a website that debunks all these things and says, oh no, this is not true. Yeah. Well, okay, if you say that it's not true, I will do the test also. So I also did the test, and actually it is true. Yeah. Microwave water and purified water. So first the clippings were allowed to grow some roots. Yeah. And then they were planted in pots. Yeah. So the left is the microwave water, and the right one is the purified water. And then in over a period of about 10 days, yeah, they were given the water. And you see on the left, it hardly grows. Yeah, it doesn't do very much. And that's because the microwave water, the microwave changes the atomic structure and the molecular structure of the water, and it becomes different. Yeah.
Excuse me, what do you mean microwave?
Put the water in the microwave oven. Boil it. Yeah. Boil it and then let it cool down. That is microwave. And here we see day 5. The one on the right still grows. The one on the left is getting less and less. Yeah. And then here is. Day 7, well, you can hardly see anything on the left anymore, yeah? And then here is the last day, day 9, and the one on the left is practically dead, Yeah, so that is what micro...
Irrigate with this water.
Yeah, with irrigated...
But only the first day, all the days, you irrigate with water.
Yeah, yes. And so you can see that, you know, they say the microwave is a fantastic invention. Yeah, it is a fantastic invention, but it's not good for your food. No, not for making tea, because then you get the same. Yeah? After 9 days of drinking the tea, you will be dwindled.
Did you microwave the soil?
No, we did not microwave the soil, we microwaved the water. Yeah? I wouldn't want to microwave the soil, because then you kill everything inside. Yeah?
There's a good experience in Poland, microwaving the soil.
Ah, yeah? Yes, yes.
And one Holland has an idea to make a machine that microwaves all the soils.
Uh-oh.
And make a big machine, and he's microwaving all the greenhouses inside.
Oh. They're
really
happy. Sure they are.
Let me see. Mm. That is mango, so now we have to go first to the other ones. Yeah, this is a mango tree. This mango tree had been eaten by termites. And the person was asking me if anything could be done for that. And I said, well, you can try something with camphora, because camphora will drive out the white ant or the termite, yeah. But if you look at the way that the tree is at the moment, I do not think it will survive. He has tried it, and he is also given carbo-veg because of loss of vital fluids. He's not gotten back to me how the tree is at the moment. Yeah, but this tree was in the courtyard. This is in India, and it had been there for 3 generations already, so they didn't want to lose the tree. But I think that this tree will not survive. Yeah, because if you see how everything has been eaten away, there is little chance for it to survive. But at the same time, after, this is a different mango tree in the same garden, and he also had some problems with that. He gave this also carbo-veg, he said, and afterwards the problem was gone and the leaves were all coming very nicely. But he was not very clear about what problem it was. Now here we have silica. Everybody is always talking about silica, especially Rudolf Steiner. Rudolf Steiner, he says silica is a very important remedy. I say silica is the key to agriculture, because without silica no plant will ever stand upright. If there was no silica in our own bodies, we would be a blob on the floor. Yeah. So
if you have shown the tree that will not survive, I will suggest Kalibacrobicum for that tree.
Well, I shall write him about it.
Yes.
If it's still alive, then he can do
it. Then they can use it.
Yeah. This is a test about clover, red clover. Now, red clover grows maybe 25, 30 centimeters. And this is a man in South India, a very earnest man. And he said he has all these rock dust from the local mountains. Okay, potentize that according to Hanuman's principles. Yeah, and then, triturate and apply this to your plants, and he did. And he was very happy with the result, because this little clover is not 30 centimeters, but it's 60 centimeters high. It's twice as tall, and just from one dose. Yeah, so silica can also not only make your plants stronger, but it can increase the harvest, and here is the measuring stick. In the measuring stick has 60 centimeters, and you can see how big it is. And the flowers normally are half the size of what they are there, yeah. And the flowers become bigger also. So silica to me is like one of the most important remedies for agriculture. It helps in seed germination. It helps in re-establishing plants after transplant when they stay puny. They don't really want to grow. Give it a dose of silica and there they go. So your plants, your trees there in the orchards that you were talking about before, your plants, your trees that were having the problem with where always the aphids come, give them silica. And it will make them a lot stronger, and will make the skin of the tree so hard that the aphid can no longer penetrate. And then they will go somewhere else. And if you then also use the coccinella, you don't kill the aphid. You don't need to kill the aphid. Let the aphid do some other work. Yeah? You must put these things to work for you. Don't try to kill. In homeopathy, we do not kill. We cure. And cure means life. And killing means death. We are not into death. We don't like that. Yeah? You can put these things to work for you. Yeah? So if you give your trees the remedy, yeah, the coccinella, then the aphids will have to eat something else. Well, don't make sure that the weeds don't get the coccinella, and then the aphid will go to the weed and eat the weed, and so you don't have to do the weeding. Yeah, you put them to work. Yeah, if you want to work with nature, then you work with nature in a way that you put them to work. And the same with the snails. Yeah, snails and slugs. Yeah, you give Helix tosta, which is toasted snail, to the plants, and you don't give anything to the weeds. And yeah, well, the snails have to survive too, so they will go to the weeds and they will eat the weeds for you. Yeah? So you put them to work. Don't kill them. That is silly. Everything in nature has its function. Yeah? And because it has a function, then, well, take advantage of that function and use it, yeah, so that you have less work to do. I'm saying to every farmer, you have to become a lazy farmer. Yeah, you are all working far too hard. You're doing all these things to control everything. Yeah, it's not a matter of control. It's a matter of harmonious working together. Yeah, you cannot control nature. It is impossible. Yeah, man has been trying that for thousands of years, and look what a mess he made with his control. Yeah, so control is not possible. We have already seen that control doesn't lead to anything. You must not control, you must assist. You must help it and let it help you. Yeah, it is a mutual relationship. We are a symbiosis with nature. We are not separate from nature. Yeah, we are part of it. And, you know, humans usually think that they are above nature and they can control everything, but that's not the case. Yeah, we are part of it, so we should play our role inside of it and use what is in nature to our advantage and to nature's advantage. And that is the way to go about. Otherwise, you fight a losing battle. Always. Nature is much stronger. And nature always, at some point, gives you some form of punishment. Here you can see, well, you know, that is as long as his arm. Yeah? So he was very happy with that, and since that time, every year, he is using, at the beginning of the season, he's using a dose of silica, and he is very happy with the result. This was in 2008 when he did that, and he's very happy with that.
Can I ask, do you use liquid remedies, or would you use pills?
I use liquid remedies.
Or does it matter?
I use liquid remedy, but it doesn't matter, because both contain the same energy. Yeah, this is amaranth. Amaranth is a leafy vegetable that is eaten in India. Amaranth also grows 40, 50 centimeters, and that's it. These plants are more than a meter tall. Yeah, and that's from the same dose of silica, done by the same man, and he's very happy with it. The leaves are also twice as big as normal. And silica makes the outside of the leaf a bit harder, but they cook this anyway, and they say that the taste is better as well. Yeah, so it improves taste as much as anything else. Here you have some more of this amaranth, and you can see how tall it grows. And here is more of the same amaranth, and here is the man himself who did that. And you see, he's a very serious fellow. Yeah. He
seems to be very sober with
Ah. Yeah, yeah. So, his name is Jagadanjan. And he is from South India. He's from Tamil Nadu. Then here, let me see, what was this? The pomegranate. Oh, yes. Here, the pomegranate. You see how it's all cracked up? Yeah? So he was asking me, what can I do about that? So he said, give it a dose of calcium phosphate. Yeah, because the plant is fruiting, and in fruiting, the plant needs extra phosphor, and calcium will strengthen the skin of the plant. Yeah. So also, he is on a rather acidic soil there, and calcium phosphate will change the acidity of the soil. It will make it more alkaline. And when it's more alkaline, then you have better results. And this is like 3 weeks later. And the photo is a bit small again, so let's blow it up. And the cracks have all closed, yeah? And the fruits look perfect, yeah? So he was very happy with that.
What's this
fruit? Pardon?
What fruit is this?
This is a kind of pomegranate.
But not the European one?
No, it's not a European one. They are bigger, yeah? And they do very nice.
You're talking about various remedies as you
yes.
go along. Can you actually mix these remedies together? I mean, I'm getting a picture of how many times would you have to spray in the course of a season? Could you, at the start of a season, put three or four different things into the same mixture?
You could, but there is a little bit of a problem there. Because you see, if you look in the Materia Medica for humans, then you see that phosphor and potassium are each other's friends. But in plants, they are each other's enemies. Because if you put too much potassium, the phosphor gets locked up. And if you put too much phosphor, the potassium gets locked up. And the plant cannot take it up. So the relationship of remedies for plants is different in many instances as they are for humans. So if you look in the Materia Medica and you see, oh yeah, these remedies can be put together, and then you give that to the plant and you get completely the opposite result. So the relationship of remedies for plants has not been sorted out sufficiently to say, okay, we can put this all together. Mm. Yeah, that's why I'm a single remedy man, and I say, approach things as they come. Mm. And the best prophylactic for everything is always silica. Silica will make the plant strong, yeah? And when you have strong and healthy plants, why would they get sick? Why would they get pests? Yeah, so the best prophylactic is silica at the beginning of the season, or even soaking your seeds overnight in silica. Yeah, you get stronger seedlings coming out of that. They will have no damping off. They will have no fungal diseases. Yeah, they grow strong and healthy. And so that is the main thing. And then if a problem arises, you can approach that individually. Because you say, well, you know, so many different remedies have to be sprayed. Well, she was talking before this morning, yeah, and she is saying she has to spray 5-6 times in the season. So she also has to do a lot of spraying. If you use the predators of the insects that you try to combat, there is the predator principle. Any predator from any insect will control that insect, 100% guaranteed. Yeah, I stick my neck out and let the guillotine fall if it is wrong what I say. Yeah, I can guarantee you that any predator from any pest, yeah, will control that pest, 100%. And a single dose is enough. I use the 6X. Always. I have tried out so many different potencies. Some you get better results than with others. But now I have been thinking about this a little bit more. Yeah, because the potencies actually, they follow a Fibonacci series. Yeah, you know the Fibonacci series? Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34. 55, 89, and 144. These are the potencies which with nuclear magnetic resonance show the greatest force. So I think that from now on I'm going to do, if I get a place where I can experiment again, I'm going to use these potencies and see if they work better. Yeah, because they have the greatest force when they follow the Fibonacci series. Everything in nature follows Fibonacci.
Till now you are insisting on 6X.
Yes, till now I have been insisting on 6X because my experience has taught me that works the best.
So when you experience it, please let us know.
Yes, of course I will. Don't worry about it. Everybody needs to know. Yeah? So I think that, let me see. Yes. Here, these are peas, yeah, and the peas are not doing very well. They also get damping off. This is in a polytunnel. This is also in India, yeah. This is the same man of the big pomegranates, yeah. And he was asking me,
same
man.
Huh?
The same, no, not the pomegranate man, not the serious fellow from South India. This guy is from the north. Yeah. he was asking me, what can I do about this? Because here at the base of the stem, you can see it is rotting a bit. This is like damping off. Yeah. And so I said to him, well, we can do something. Yeah, tell me, here, you see how the stem goes completely brown? This is like a rot. Yeah, and it looks like the plant has lost the vital fluids because everything is hanging. So he said, okay, give it carbo-veg. Yeah, okay, so he gave it carbo-veg. And the next thing was, here are the plants. After a dose of carbo-veg, and this is like 48 hours later. Carbo-vegetabilis. Vegetable charcoal, yeah. This is 48 hours later, and you can see the result. Yeah, they all look very, very nice and beautiful. And I said it was beans, but it's actually not beans, it's cucumbers. Yeah, and you see how everything is nice and healthy, and he's very happy with the result. Yeah, so...
Is he smiling now?
Yeah, yeah, the plants are smiling, and so is the man. Now, if you want to know more about my work, there is a website called Homeopathy for Everyone. www.homeopathyforeveryone, and then 4 is as a number. Yeah, and it's all no spaces in between. homeopathyforeveryone.com, and there I have a monthly column on plant problems. So if you have any questions, send me a photo. Yeah. Ask the question, I will give you the answer to the best of my ability. I have been doing that for 2 years there already, so you can look at previous records. Yeah, I started in September 2009, now it is October 2011. Yeah, so it's been going on for 2 years. And there is another one, it's called Homeopathy Plus in Australia, where I do the same. Yeah, so that's like a monthly column. People are asking questions. I'm giving the answers to the best of my ability.
Homeopathy with 2 O's or 3 O's?
That is with 2 O's. It's homeopathy. Yeah? Homeopathy. Homeopathy is Greek, eh? Homeos. Homeos, the same. Yeah? It's a Greek word.
Otherwise, also points out that. But the current use is 2 O's, eh? O and...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It could be 3, but...
No,
yeah.
It could be 3. Homo, H-O-M-O, E-O. No.
Homuyo. That is the proper way, yeah. But actually the O and the E are connected, because in Greek that is one letter. I remember that much of my Greek. Let me see, what else do I have for you?
Do you have anything on olive beetles?
Pardon?
Olive beetles.
Olive beetles? Well, beetles, yes? Okay, beetles, in general, I have noticed beetles you can control with 2 different remedies. One of them is Lidum palustre, yeah? Or Lidum palustre, marsh tea. It's also called wild rosemary, yeah? I was reading in a herbal book of 1776 from the United States. They were using it as a powder to control Colorado potato beetle. So I said, well, if it works in the powder, potencies always work better. Hahnemann already established this. Yeah, anything that works in the crude works better in the potency. So I have recommended several people use Leiden Palustre, and I have not got any negative results. I have only got positive results from that. And the other one is Tuya. Tuya is a very good one for beetles. And of course, there are some natural predators of the beetle. Yeah. One of them is praying mantis. I haven't made that yet as a remedy, but the praying mantis will certainly work for that.
Praying yeah? What?
Praying mantis.
Is the
beetspring, beethoischrekko, dat was hij dat. Ja. Ja. The vines. Oh, that is. There is only one one picture here. Here is another one. This is a Japanese test. Yeah, this is with tomatoes. The one on the left didn't get any remedy, and the one on the right did get the remedy. And so they have several pictures. They don't tell what remedy, but they say the effect of medication on the adult plant. And you can see there is a big difference between them. Yeah, the one on the left is medicated, the one on the right is the control. Yeah. These Japanese people, they have not said what remedy they've used. Here is the same, the one on the left is the control, the one on the right is a medicated one. Yeah. And that is unseasoned cultivation. And here is the last one. And that's the same thing, the one on the left, that's 70 days old cotton plants. The one on the left has been medicated, the one on the right is the control. So you see how much an increase you can get. You report 30%. I have seen 70%, 80% increases in results in yield from cotton plants in India. And I have seen similar things with corn, also in India. I have heard from friends in Australia that and in New Zealand, where they have these different orchards, yeah, kiwis and stuff, that they had 30-40% increase in production. So homeopathy is very good for the farmer. And the way I always spread it is I go to the farmer's wife, because she holds the purse string. Yeah, and she has a little garden in which they don't put any poison, and they still have a problem. So then you go there and you say, okay, what is your biggest problem? And you give them a free sample, and you apply that for them. And then 6 weeks later, she will say to the husband, hey, you know, you have all these problems with all these pests, and there was a guy here, and he gave me this and this and this stuff. Yeah. And I haven't seen anything for 6 weeks. I don't have to spray, so why don't you use it on the land? Because it will save you a lot of money. Yeah, because she holds the purse string, she will persuade the husband. And that's the best way to spread it. Yeah, because a farmer is as stubborn as a mule. Yeah? He will not change, because he is fixed in his idea. So you persuade first the wife, and the wife will persuade the farmer. Yeah? But that's the best way to do it.
she may kill you.
Things may be different in Pakistan. Yeah, well, in the West, it works like that. In Pakistan, it may indeed be different. Yeah, just like in India. Yeah, because there it works a little bit different. But in the West, that is the way to spread it. And then what I did in Australia, I say, okay, become a member of the co-op. And then you make a co-op, and once you have a co-op and you have so many farmers coming in your co-op, you have political clout and you can change the laws. Ah, yeah? And when you can change the laws, you can kick out all this Monsanto nonsense, yeah? And you can kick out all these chemicals, because you can change the laws because you have clout. You have so many farmers that come in your co-op and make a big and strong group. Yeah, so if we want this to spread, then we also have to be politically active. I'm sorry to say, but that's the way it works in this world.
Hold that thought for Sunday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.